Good morning, and thank you for joining us this morning for Winship Grand Rounds. If you are an Emory University or healthcare employee and would like to receive CME credit hours for attending today, the login information can be found in the chat at the bottom of your screen. If you have any issues with this webinar or the CME login, please send Julie Hawkins an email or drop a note via the chat feature. And that just went up. This morning, we are very excited to welcome Dr. Ashish Khanna. Dr. Khanna is an assistant professor in the Department of Rehabilitation Medicine at Emory University School of Medicine. He serves as director of cancer rehabilitation at the Winship Cancer Institute at Emory University. Dr. Khanna completed his residency in physical medicine and rehabilitation at Kingsbrook Jewish Medical Center in Brooklyn, New York, and his fellowship in cancer rehabilitation at MedStar Georgetown University Hospital, Lombardi Comprehensive Cancer Center, and the National Rehabilitation Hospital in Washington, D.C. He is board certified in physical medicine and rehabilitation. Dr. Khanna focuses on the identification and treatment of neuromuscular, musculoskeletal, and other issues resulting from cancer and related treatments, including aromatase inhibitor joint pains, lymphedema, pain, neuropathy, radiation fibrosis syndrome, and trismus. He is a strong advocate for cancer survivors and access to rehabilitation care and services. Prior to joining Emory, Dr. Khanna was an attending physician at Kessler Institute for Rehabilitation. He also previously served 2 years as an intramural research assistant at the National Institutes of Health. Thankfully, advances in cancer care, such as chemotherapy, radiation, and surgery, mean that more people than ever before are surviving longer after their cancer diagnosis. Unfortunately, a large fraction of them will live with at least one serious impairment as a consequence of their treatments that seriously impacts their ability to function and quality of life. Dr. Khanna's research focuses on the consequences of treatment faced by cancer patients and survivors. Dr. Khanna has written numerous book chapters and peer-reviewed scientific articles on cancer rehabilitation and is the co-author of a pocket guide for clinicians, Cancer Rehabilitation, a Concise and Portable Pocket Guide. Welcome, Dr. Khanna.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. That's a very nice introduction. I appreciate it. I'm happy to be here and thank you guys for your interest in this topic. I was going to talk a little, give myself a little bit of an introduction, but that was pretty good, so I'll probably skip that part. As she mentioned all of this stuff already here. Fellowship trained in cancer rehabilitation, and then here I'm the director of cancer rehabilitation here with you guys. So first, I'll start off by saying what exactly is a physiatrist. So a physiatrist is what we call ourselves. They didn't ask me what to call a physical medicine and a rehabilitation practitioner back in the 1940s when we picked that. I would have picked a different word, but it's not podiatrist, it's not psychiatrist, it's physiatrist. That's a practitioner of physical medicine and rehabilitation. Since we are a small specialty, and then the cancer rehabilitation being even a smaller, very small subspecialty, there's only about maybe 30 of us or so in the country. Most of us are at major cancer centers, not all, but I'll talk a little bit about what is a physiatrist, and the common questions are, you know, how do we differ from a physical therapist? So first I'll say, like many of you on this call, I went to medical school and all that. So I'm not a physical therapist myself. So like a physician, I do make, and manage medical diagnoses. I order and interpret labs, imaging, I prescribe medications, perform procedures such as nerve blocks and joint injections. I'm going to be talking about some of the ones that I do here at Winship to help our cancer patients. If appropriate, I do prescribe therapies, physical PT and OT, speech, things like that, that the therapist subsequently perform. I manage medical issues during the rehabilitative process, so medically complex patients who are undergoing rehabilitation, help manage those. But of course, at the end of the day, I collaborate very closely with physical PT, OT, and speech therapists, and we all speak the same language. And we're all one big happy family. So that's a primer there. So let's talk about what is cancer rehabilitation. Well, cancer rehabilitation itself is a process that helps cancer survivors obtain and maintain the maximum possible physical, social, psychological, and vocational functioning within the limits created by cancer and its treatments. And what is the need for cancer rehabilitation? Well, many are cured of our patients, and that's thanks to the wonderful work that so many of you guys do on this call. But of course, as we know, they're living with the effects of cancer and cancer treatments. So like a lot of people, I think of cancer sort of in the long term being sort of like a chronic disease that's likely to be associated with a disability or a change in functional status, either during or after the course of the illness. So similar to the AIDS crisis in the 1980s, when you were told, you know, that you had that you're HIV positive, you know, the prognosis was quite poor at that point. But now we have HIV and AIDS is a chronic disease, and people live many, many, many years with that. And I hope that cancer is, and I think it is moving in that direction, which is a testament to all the wonderful work that we do here. I'll talk a little bit about the prevalence of cancer in the population. You can see, I'll just draw your attention quickly to this blue bar here, which represents patients living 15 or more years. And we can see that since 1977, all of the bars, but particularly the blue bar here, has been increasing. So we have more and more cancer survivors than ever. In 2016, we had 15.5 million cancer survivors, and it's projected in 2026 that we have 20.5 million. This is another showing the age distribution. I'll just draw your attention here to the 5-year relative survival rate. And here you can see that many of them are in the 70s and 80s and 90s here as well. So the 5-year relative survival rate is really going up, which is fantastic. So we have more and more people who are considered cancer survivors. So what are some different medical issues related to cancer treatments? Well, I went through a textbook here and they had listed all of the all the different issues that cancer survivors can experience. And I went through and highlighted in light blue all the ones that I can help or those of us in the cancer rehabilitation world can address. So at the end of the day, you guys are majority of the people of you guys are treating the acute cancer patients in sort of the life-saving mode. And then down the line, as these patients are either under treatment or are considered cancer survivors into the long term, my role here would be sort of as the janitor here. And what I do really would be to clean up the issues that your patients have as related to their function and their quality of life. So let's talk about the unmet need of cancer patients quickly. This is an article here from JCO talking about the prevalence and treatment patterns of physical impairments in patients with metastatic breast cancer. They looked at 163 community-dwelling metastatic breast cancer patients and found that 92% of the patients had at least one physical impairment. So that's 9 out of 10. Among all this identified impairments, another 92% of those patients required skilled professional intervention. So we're talking about physical or occupational therapy here. There are a lot of wonderful cancer practitioners in other fields. There are massage therapists who specialize in cancer, the YMCA, the Live Strong program. We're talking here about physical and occupational and speech therapists, the skilled professional interventions. Again, another 9 out of 10 of those impairments required attention from one of those professionals. So the next question is, well, how many of these patients were addressed? And the answer is less than 1/3 in this particular study. So the vast majority of our patients, unfortunately, continue to live with physical impairments, so that they consider sort of the new normal. But I'm here to hopefully convince you guys that the new normal doesn't have to be the new normal. So what do I manage in cancer rehabilitation? I manage pain, fatigue. I'm going to talk briefly about fatigue, impaired mobility, any issues with decreased range of motion, deconditioning. With that comes weakness, impaired activities of daily living. There's trismus and cervical dystonia, trismus meaning a decreased aperture of the jaw, inability to open the mouth. Issues related to spasticity, cognition, neuropathy or nerve disorders as well. lymphedema. I'm going to mention today aromatase inhibitor arthralgias caused by a decrease in circulating estrogen. Joint pain comes from that. Radiation fibrosis syndrome as well. So I do a lot of work with patients after radiation who have impairments. As you know, there's not a lot of good treatments for radiation fibrosis. So it's sort of symptomatic management. And that's basically what I do, using Botox injections and whatever the case may be. So I've written about all these different topics, lectured, done podcasts on them and stuff like that. So it's very difficult for me to have to pick just a few topics to kind of what I feel like jam into 1 hour. So I'll try to pick some that are of interest to the wide range of practitioners here who might be on the call. First, I'll mention Revital cancer rehabilitation really quickly. So Revital is an outpatient physical and occupational therapy program. It's a joint venture between Emory and Select Medical. And basically, we have 33 certified Revital therapists. They're in 22 outpatient centers throughout the metro area. As you guys may or may not know, PT, physical and occupational therapists don't necessarily always receive a lot of oncology training. This is a program where the therapists receive, I believe, 60 hours of additional training and hands-on training. And then, you know, I help out with them and give talks, and they have office hours with some of the physicians and things like that. So throughout the metro area, we've got a bunch of these therapists, and many of them have a personal connection to cancer and are really quite passionate about treating this group. So it's nice to have a specialized group of people who are not, you know, necessarily nervous or, you know, handle our patients with kid gloves because they're scared of the diagnosis of cancer and are scared of hurting them. I am the medical director for Revital. I work very closely with the team. I talk to them every day. They email me questions. And the service basically that we offer that I can add to this wonderful group of people is the medically supervised rehabilitation. So I send patients to them, of course. If you guys send patients to Revital, the Revital therapist, if they see something that they're not sure about, they'll refer that patient to me or email me or call me or ask me questions and things like that. So we work together, and that's, I think, a great service. I'll take a few moments and talk about our first topic, which is cancer-related fatigue. And cancer-related fatigue is the most common complaint among cancer patients. So let's talk about what is cancer-related fatigue. Well, many of us are familiar with this gentleman here. Maybe some of you are like that this morning. But it's important to remember that cancer-related fatigue is not your standard fatigue. It does differ in several important ways, and I'll mention that right now. There are several definitions. The one I like is that, first of all, it has to be a fatigue lasting greater than 2 weeks and experienced every day. This is important. It is out of proportion to exertion. So a lot of people are going to be very fatigued after emptying the dishwasher or walking to the mailbox or things like that. So it has to be out of proportion to exertion. Of course, it has to be associated with a distress and a functional loss. And it's clinically associated with a cancer diagnosis and or chemotherapy, of course. And then lastly, it's not explained by a primary psychiatric diagnosis, for example, depression. This is a topic that, you know, like I said, it's the most common complaint among cancer patients. A lot of patients feel like they're lazy. Or their family sometimes, unfortunately, may make them feel that way. So it's important for me. I tell every patient that this is not laziness, that it is a real definition. It is a real disease. We understand the physiology of it, and I'm going to mention a little bit about that. So that's just something that you may want to mention to the patients. I feel like they appreciate that. So like I said, it's the most common side effect of cancer and cancer treatments. It occurs in 60 to 96% of patients during treatment. It may persist for months or years after successful treatment completion. So 30% of breast cancer survivors report fatigue 1 to 5 years post-diagnosis. 63% of fatigue survivors continue to report fatigue 5 to 10 years post-diagnosis. So I'll talk about the significance of it. This is a study from the Annals of Oncology. They looked at 538 cancer patients. In the oncologist view, of course, in the medical field, we're trained to focus more on pain and things like that. So it's not, this is, I don't think, going to be too surprising to anybody who works in this space. But in the oncologist view, pain was clinically more relevant than fatigue, 61 to 37%. But in the patient's view, fatigue actually affected their everyday life much more than pain, 61% versus 19%. In this study, 52% of the patients never reported fatigue to their oncologist, and only 14% had received treatment or advice on how to manage it. And then a third of the patients with fatigue declared that they felt that they had not received adequate treatment for that. So what causes fatigue? As we know, it's multifactorial, which is an understatement. We have comorbid medical conditions. There are the biological factors, particularly inflammation, which I'll mention. Demographic factors, there are psychosocial factors, health behaviors, and then comorbid symptoms as well. So really what causes fatigue? It's really the neuroendocrine immune mediators, this mechanism here. You can start on the left here, and you can see that we have all the different cancer and its treatments, which results in inflammation. And then we have the cycle of the impacting the sleep-wake cycle, the neuroendocrine system, ultimately impacting the central nervous system here. The most important aspect of this has been shown to be inflammation. So the pro-inflammatory cytokines, in fact, there are studies, which I don't have time to include here, that show that patients who have higher TNF-alpha in their blood do show decreased frontal lobe, I think inferior frontal gyrus activity on fMRI. So there is a direct correlation between the level of inflammation and the amount of fatigue that you have. So what do we do about it? The treatment team members, this is from the NCCN guidelines, referral to a physiatrist or supervised rehabilitation program if the patient is suffering to a great extent. The number one intervention that we have is actually exercise. This is a category one recommendation. So asking somebody who's fatigued to exercise, of course, is not an easy thing to do. But we do have strategies for that, and that's something that in the rehabilitation area we can help you with, designing customized exercise programs. Normally I recommend 150 minutes a week of moderate level activity, rather than giving a target heart rate, which is, you know, I think complicates things and people start focusing on what their Fitbit or Apple Watch, how what their heart rate is. I say moderate level exercise would be exercising to the point where you're short of breath, but can still hold a conversation. And that's moderate level exercise. And 150 minutes a week, 30 minutes, 5 days a week would be the target. That's the dose and intensity that we see in studies that show to help with fatigue. As far as the diagnosis, we screen and treat for underlying medical causes. That's primarily what I do in my clinic. Check, make sure the patient's not anemic, make sure they're not hypothyroid. We discuss issues about the, you know, depression, optimism for the future, things like that. Vitamin D levels, there's a lot of different things that I check in the clinic for that. And then lastly, there are the pharmacological, which are the psychostimulants, also mentioned in the NCCN guidelines. I rarely prescribe these. There's different evidence for modafinil versus methylphenidate. If I was going to pick one, I usually, based on my review of the literature and colleagues, I would go with modafinil 200 milligrams. But like I said, a lot of these patients have difficulty sleeping and things like that. So this is sort of the last resort. I have a lot of expertise in chest wall pain syndromes. I work a lot, very closely with a lot of the breast and the plastic surgeons for our next topic that we're gonna mention, which is a post-mastectomy pain syndrome. So, post-mastectomy pain syndrome is sort of considered like a chronic neuropathic pain condition that occurs following breast cancer treatments. And really it's a syndrome that consists of a number of different conditions. It starts anytime after surgery, but typically if it persists beyond the normal healing time, I say that about 3 months, just to make sure that this particular pain is not a post-op pain. And of course it's pain located in the chest wall, axilla, arm, shoulder, breast. And then the next thing is it really a neuropathic condition? I would argue that's a musculoskeletal and neuropathic condition. but traditionally in the literature it's been considered a neuropathic condition. What is the frequency? I'll just draw your attention here to the, to the last line. This is frequency of shoulder issues that I see all the time in the clinic here. After 4 years, about 23% of patients report shoulder stiffness, 29% report arm swelling, 55% with arm numbness, and then just general shoulder pain afterwards. And I'll show you one example of why we see so much shoulder pain with breast cancer surgeries. But post-mastectomy pain syndrome doesn't necessarily, it's a misnomer, and not necessarily have to be after mastectomies. It can be after lumpectomies, axillary node dissections, reconstruction, and augmentation as well. Chemotherapies, radiation, of course, can cause issues in the chest wall, and then there are the hormonal treatments. One type of issue that we see in this particular population is an intercostal brachial neuralgia. This is a nerve. It's a cutaneous branch of the second intercostal nerve. It supplies the posterior upper arm, axilla, and lateral chest wall. It's an increased risk of injury during axillary node dissection and with radiation. And it results in a neuropathic pain of the axilla, the arm, and the breast. So one of the most useful treatments that we have for this is actually just a targeted nerve block. Here you can see this is the patient's axilla here. I usually do a little bit further down the arm, really more like this photograph here, showing where with the, using the ultrasound, we're able to locate that nerve and infiltrate with that with steroid and anesthetic, and it's a typical nerve block sort of fashion. Another nerve block that I do that I find useful that I've done a study with at my previous institution is called the serratus plane block. This is what I sort of use for when patients have a subjective sense of tightness. I think tightness has been a very difficult symptom to treat, and that's basically why I decided to study it. Tightness can come from from a dystonia. Muscular contraction, either of the intercostals, of the flap being used, of the pectoralis, and that responds well to Botox. And then tightness can just be a neuropathic condition as well. If I feel like it's a neuropathic condition, then I usually address it with this nerve block here, where we're just basically infiltrating the space. It's a plane where we have the perforating nerves here. You can see these yellow dots between the latissimus and the serratus. We again use a steroid and infiltrate that area with an anesthetic as well. I feel like then, and the studies, I'm publishing one here later this year, showing some improvement with that as it relates to tightness, which has really been a very difficult symptom historically to treat. Just to give another example of sort of what I do and what I can help out with. An example of post-reconstruction pain, we have patients who have tissue expanders placed behind the pectoralis. Of course, that's going to stretch the pectoralis muscle. Here's another view of that. So it pays, of course, to kind of look at the pectoralis muscle. And, you know, I am a musculoskeletal physician as well, so I do a lot of sort of the sports medicine side of things in my training. So we kind of look at this. And if you imagine you're going to reach in and you're going to grab that pectoralis muscle and pull it out, you can imagine that the pectoralis at the clavicular head is going to pull the shoulder down. It's going to protract the shoulder. Also, it's going to, as the humeral attachment is going to cause you to abduct the arm, right? So the patient's arm is going to be pulled towards their body, and they're going to have a lot of sensitivity here with micro tears at the insertion at the sternal border as well, a lot of tenderness there. So let's just imagine if you pull the shoulder down, what happens? Well, you're going to decrease the subacromial space, and that's going to result in a rotator cuff impingement. So you can imagine if this is the clavicle here, you have the AC joint, the acromion, which is part of your scapula, is going to get pulled down. And of course, that's going to, you have your poor supraspinatus, one of your rotator cuff tendons stuck here between a rock and a hard place. And you will see a rotator cuff impingement. And I see that all the time. The other issue, when you stretch a muscle, any of the breast flaps that are used, even including the pectoralis, you can get spasms there. When you stretch a muscle, it could spasm back on you. And those can be very painful spasms. And for that, I do Botox injections. Again, ultrasound guided, particularly if we're going to do it over an implant. I don't want to put the needle in the implant. So I actually did this yesterday. So use the ultrasound for that. here's just a picture of how we do that, so prevent puncture of the implant. I can also use EMG guidance as well. Typically, I do the pectoralis, serratus anterior, and latissimus dorsi, and that's usually the amount that we do. So the next topic that I'm going to mention, we're going to talk a little bit about lymphedema. So this is a topic I think may be of interest to a lot of people. So I'll start by asking a question. Does anybody want to wager and guess how long does the average medical student spend learning about the lymphatic system? 5 minutes, 30 minutes, 2 hours, or 8 hours? The answer is 30 minutes. That's about as long as we spend learning about the lymphatic system. So I'm about to double or triple your knowledge of lymphedema. So this is another area I have a lot of expertise in. So I'll mention the lymphatic system quickly. It's actually the lymphatic system essentially lives sort of, it's very superficial. It lives sort of under the skin in a lot of cases, a lot of locations. It has similarities to arteries and veins. It shares features of both of those, but it's unique in its own way too. The first way that it's unique is that the lymphatic system is a blind end tube. It's not as we think like a capillary bed where we have arteries and veins and anastomose with each other. So interstitial fluid is drained into these blind end tubes. Like arteries, they are muscular. So there is a muscle cell and it causes the lymphatic vessel to actually beat. It beats about every 6 to 10 seconds or 6 to 10 times a minute either way. And like veins, it has valves. So it does prevent backflow, what we call dermal backflow of lymphatic fluid. This is the one, the primary unit of the lymphatic system is called the lymphangion. So pretty interesting stuff. I think a lot of people don't realize that. So it's kind of cool. Here's a picture of a lymphatic collector here on a high power view. You can see the valve here. And then again, like I said, there are muscle cells as well. Lymphedema occurs basically because we have a cycle of lymphostasis resulting in inflammation. That inflammation causes further damage to the lymph nodes here. So we have destruction of lymph vessels, obliteration of lymph nodes. That causes an increase in the lymphedema, and that results in an increased lymphatic load, and that's how the cycle just continues like that. So we really need to break that cycle of lymphedema and inflammation. A lot of skin manifestations in chronic lymphostasis. The first one I'll mention is a lipodermatosclerosis. This is one that we see more so as a result of lymphovenous stasis. And the lower extremity here. There's another one that's common called a sclerosing panniculitis. Panniculitis, I'll mention really quickly, is a condition. It's a simmering sort of infection of the adipose tissue. That's why it's called a panniculitis. It's an adipose tissue, low level infection. However, it's often treated as cellulitis. If you go to the emergency room, they probably will get antibiotics for this. You don't really need antibiotics for this. So. Differentiating between a panniculitis and a cellulitis is important because, of course, the majority of lymphedema patients are overtreated with antibiotics because of this condition. Once you have a chronic panniculitis, it becomes a sclerosing panniculitis, and then you'll see an inverted wine bottle sort of shape to the leg as well. Another thing I'll talk about here is to sort of debunk some of the myths about lymphedema. I thought this was a great article here from NJCO in 2016. It talks about the impact of ipsilateral blood draws, injections, blood pressure measurements, and also air travel on the risk of lymphedema for patients treated for breast cancer. So there's a lot of misinformation on the internet. I think almost more than anything I treat, probably lymphedema, there's so much misinformation on the internet, and people always go to their forums. And of course, if you see it on the internet, it must be true, right? So let's talk about this article quickly. The purpose was to investigate the association between blood draws, injections, blood pressure readings, trauma, cellulitis in the at-risk arm, and air travel. So they looked at newly diagnosed invasive breast cancer treatments, and they were screened prospectively for lymphedema. This included sentinel node and axillary node dissection patients. Bilateral arm volume measurements were taken. At each measurement, the patients were surveyed, and then the arm volume was quantified. They looked at 632 patients, taking 3,000 measurements. Median follow-up here was 24 months. Median time between measurements was 7 months. In this patient population that they had studied, 71% underwent a sentinel node biopsy. Overall, 6% had an episode of cellulitis, and almost half of those were immediately post-op. So that's interesting to note there. And I see that in my clinic too. About half of the cellulitis episodes happen immediately postoperatively. At 24 months, the cumulative incidence of lymphedema in this group was 7.72%. Right, likely because the majority of the patients underwent sentinel node biopsy. If there were more axillary node dissections, of course, this number would have been higher. But to summarize, what did they find? They found that axillary lymph node dissection. So these are sort of the nothing groundbreaking here in the left column. These are relatively well-established causes of lymphedema in the literature. Axillary node dissection, regional node irradiation, BMI greater than 25. Obesity is actually the number one cause of lymphedema in the United States. And venous hypertension is number two. And then we have cellulitis, naturally, as you might expect, would result in an exacerbation of lymphedema. The interesting stuff here in the right column is what may not be associated with an increased risk of lymphedema. One is blood draws. So phlebotomy is what we're talking about here. Injections, COVID vaccines, flu shots. Blood pressure readings, you can, I tell patients it's okay to get blood pressure readings on that arm. And then air travel, both the number and duration of flights did not reach statistical significance here. So hopefully this sort of further contradicts the conventional recommendations that we have, that blood draws, injections, blood pressure, things on air travel would cause lymphedema. So I hope that this study and this knowledge can sort of hopefully unburden a lot of men and women about a lot of their concerns. Of course, you know, lymphedema causes a lot of anxiety, understandably. But I will mention that risk reduction practices are still important. If you can do the blood draw on the other arm, you might as well do it. This study, of course, doesn't debunk risk reduction practices, but I think it's good to at least understand that aspect of lymphedema. So I am a lymphedema physician. If you want to tell people, we have a lymphologist at Winship, you're welcome to do that. I consider myself sort of a one-stop shop for lymphedema. I do the differential diagnosis of edema, whether it's cardiogenic, lipedema, lipolymphedema, or phlebolymphedema. I order and interpret lymphoscintigraphies as well. That's the image that you see here. To map the lymphatics. There's also issues with cording. I do assessment of patients, prescribe appropriate garments, lots of patient education, prevention of complications, and then the appropriate treatment of cellulitis as well. We do have some novel treatments that I can discuss with some patients who are particularly affected. There's a lymphovenous anastomosis, lymphovenous bypass, and then there's another one called a vascularized lymph node transfer. So what are the institutional benefits of cancer rehabilitation? Let me actually just take a break and close this blind here. Sorry about that. I can see it's coming. There we go. So I'll talk about some of the institutional benefits of cancer rehabilitation. To Winship and Emory and University Hospital in general. It results in ease in reaching benchmarks that we have to reach at our cancer center, and of course meets the requirements to address survivorship issues. It results in a lower cost of care, decreased hospital admissions, length of stay, ER visits, decreased global cost to the cancer center, results in more frequent return to work for our patients, and of course, at the end of the day, results in improved functional outcomes and patient satisfaction. And at the end of the day, like I said, it's really about the optimized quality of life as well. So what are some of the future directions as the new director of cancer rehabilitation here? There's some things I'd like to roll out at our institution. I thought I'll just mention that here quickly, and many of you guys may be interested in collaborating, which would be great. I'm sort of new. I started here officially in October, but with COVID, things got off to a little bit of a slower start. So we're trying our best to do all these different types of things. So here's some two examples of some future things that I'd like to do here at Winship that I have colleagues that have successfully done at other cancer centers. One is dealing with lung cancer. So I'll just mention rehabilitation in the age of low dose CT screening. This is an article, an area of interest of mine, and something that I published here. So this is the next couple slides are from an article that I wrote. It's about the use of low dose CT scanning. And as we know, this should improve survival of our patients through earlier detection. Because of that, it creates a large population of patients with survivorship needs. And this is in a cohort of patients who previously had lower survival rates as compared to patients with other tumor types. And here is really the role of what we call prehabilitation. So prehabilitation is basically where we do rehabilitation before the impairment develops. So usually in the world of rehabilitation, we are on the back end of things. So patients have a spinal cord injury, they have a traumatic brain injury, all those different types of rehabilitation medicine that we practice. And we have no way to predict who's going to have a brain injury and who's going to have a spinal cord injury and all those types of things. But this is different because based on the patient's treatment plan that we discuss at a tumor board, I can reasonably tell you what sort of outcomes and physical impairments that this patient is going to have. So if we know in advance, then that means we can do something about it. And that's where prehabilitation comes in. Basically, we tune up the patient as best we can for their upcoming surgery and chemotherapy and other cancer treatments. Here in the treatment of lung cancer, here's a patient reported symptoms with lung cancer. Fatigue is one. We talked about that already. Shortness of breath is another one. And then we have fatigue, and then interference with daily activities. All of these can be addressed with prehabilitation. And as you can see from the graph, these are some of the highest, most frequently reported symptoms. We can do it before surgery. There's literature showing that pulmonary rehabilitation before surgery decreases post-op complications, hospital length of stay, increases preoperative oxygen consumption, and increases a 6-minute walk distance. Results in a lower incidence of atelectasis and hospital-acquired infections, reduces morbidity and length of stay. Even after surgery, we show some benefits here as well. Changes in the 6-minute walk test, changes to the VO2 max, and less hospital days as well. Pulmonary rehabilitation for non-operative lung cancer as well can benefit these patients. Again, with increases in the 6-minute walk test here. One of the other topics, and I mean, this is something that we could talk about for a long time, but we'll move on because we have other things to cover. One of the other, the next topic that I'd like to talk about that we, an issue that we have at Winship and a lot of other cancer centers is the issue of frailty. So I'll mention what is frailty. It's a clinically recognizable state of increased vulnerability resulting from age-associated decline in reserve and function. Basically, what we're talking about here is patients who have a reduced functional reserve. These are our frail patients. Their ability to cope with everyday or acute stressors is compromised. And you know, when we have a frail patient, because they have a decreased functional reserve, they're not able to cope with even small stressors. It sort of starts this cycle of deconditioning, cycle of weakness, and the patients continue to get worse and worse and worse. And the idea here is that hopefully we can kind of stop this domino effect by intervening in a meaningful way and keep these patients healthier for longer and reduce that sort of cycle of frailty. So cancer rehabilitation, really, I consider it an opportunity for our institution. According to the NCI, a National Coalition for Cancer Survivorship, an individual is considered a cancer survivor from the time of cancer diagnosis through the balance of his or her life. That can hopefully be a long period of time. And as you guys know, recently this discussion on the balance of life, living well with cancer, these survivorship issues are really taking a front seat these days. There's more and more in the media, there's more and more discussion about these type of survivorship issues. And the role of providers, of who's doing that, is not yet clearly defined. And, you know, I think this is a great opportunity, honestly, for Winship to sort of grab the bull by the horns and really excel in this area and say that, you know, this is important to us, as it is important to almost everybody in society, caregivers and everyone involved in care of the cancer patient. So hopefully, you know, this is something that we can focus on. And you guys share my passion for this topic. So, in summary, let me do a time check here. Yeah, we're doing well. Cancer rehabilitation improves function and quality of life for cancer patients. And then I myself in my clinic, I treat a multitude of survivorship issues associated with cancer and cancer treatments. I'll take a moment here at the end to mention when to refer to cancer rehabilitation medicine versus directly to therapy. That's a common question. Of course, there's only one of me. Hopefully next year there'll be more. I'll hire somebody else. But at the moment, it's only me. And we have thousands and thousands of cancer patients that we see at Winship every year. I wish I had the volume to see them all, but I don't. So we, of course, depend a lot on our physical therapy colleagues to help us out. So the question naturally becomes, when is it the patient appropriate to send to me, and when is it appropriate to send them directly to therapy? The first one I'll say is, if the issue or impairment is such that rehabilitation is the best treatment option, then that's the best, that's sort of a time to send them to both of us. If the patient is medically complex, then that's probably a referral that's better to me. As a physician, I help manage medically complex patients during rehabilitation. If the patient requires physician supervision during rehabilitation, if the diagnosis is unclear, like you guys here on the call, many of you who are, you know, are diagnosticians, this is something that I do. Like I said, I order lab tests, imaging, all that stuff all the time. If you're unsure what rehabilitation interventions are most appropriate, if you have a patient, you know that they need rehabilitation, not sure where to send them. That's something I do a lot of coordination of care, and I write very detailed physical and occupational therapy prescriptions. Including, you know, contraindications to therapy, and, you know, different caution, you know, this or whatever the case may be. If barriers exist to rehabilitation, for example, pain, that's essentially one of the biggest roles I do, is removing barriers to rehabilitation. If you have somebody who you'd like to send to therapy, but they have an issue that you think would prevent them from fully participating, then that's, I get a lot of referrals for that reason, and that's something that I'm very happy to do. For example, if the patient has joint pain, here I am, this is actually my mother here. I'm doing a knee injection with her here with the ultrasound guidance. If the patients have a lot of neuropathies, if they have musculoskeletal or neuromuscular issues, that's something that I can help with. EMGs, things like that can be done. If the patients particularly have spasms, that would be a good trigger word. Hopefully you guys will think of me when the patients have muscle spasms. I do a lot of complex Botox interventions using ultrasound guidance. And I do hundreds and hundreds of units of Botox every week to help these types of patients with head and neck cancers, with cervical dystonia, with breast flaps, like I mentioned, can spasm, things like that, but lots of different things. Issues related to radiation or radiation fibrosis, this is another area of expertise of mine, published on this and all sorts of stuff. You can see these patients have, this patient has a neck extensor weakness as a result of head and neck cancer. This is a Hodgkin's lymphoma patient, I believe. And then you see we can have general atrophy here as a result of radiation. This is just an example, of course, we can talk about this for more than an hour. But these are some of the things that hopefully you guys are able to keep in mind. And that's it for me. If you guys have any questions, let me know. Here's how to, this is, my current clinic setup. I'm at Clifton on Mondays and Wednesdays on the second floor with many of you guys. I go to our new Decatur DeKalb Medical on Tuesdays, and then Thursdays I'm at the Midtown Head and Neck Clinic on the 10th floor, working with just our head and neck cancer patients. If you're interested, you have some patients in mind, hopefully you do, Winship, the Winship Hemonc referrals pool. In Cerner, you can also do an internal order. There's cancer rehab is in the drop-down list of specialty requested. Of course, an internal referral with my name directly to me, or you can email or message me as well. And this is my email address here. All right. Thank you guys very
Great.
Much. Yeah, I appreciate
Thank
it.
You. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Khanna. I see we already have two great questions, but if you do have any questions, please use the Q&A feature located at the bottom of the screen. I wanted to let you know before we get started on those that next week's Grand Round speaker will be Dr. Rama Rao Amara from the Emory Vaccine Center. And to view all upcoming Winship Grand Rounds lectures, please visit the Grand Rounds page on the Winship Cancer Center website or the Winship calendar. So Dr. Lawson posted two great questions already. The first says, when we say that X percent of cancer survivors have fatigue, what is the number for age, BMI, et cetera, match controls?
Oh, that is a good question. So, you know, I don't have that information, of course, on hand at the moment, but I do see that patients who are in the, our elderly patients do have more significant fatigue. The BMI, of course, I believe from what I see also correlates to that. But it's not always. I mean, younger patients, so there are a lot of issues. Like I said, if I don't know if I can quickly go back to that, the slide where I showed all the psychosocial different factors, the catastrophizing coping style has a lot to do with it. Social stressors have a lot to do with it. Depression, nutrition, all those sorts of things play a role in that. If that's Dr. Lawson, I can get you that information if you like. It's a good question though.
Great. And then one more from Dr. Lawson. There is talk of trauma-informed care based on the fact that, for example, 25% of women and 16% of men have been sexually abused. Adverse childhood experiences are said to affect people for life. Is this something that you and or we should be taking into account and or perhaps investigating?
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I missed the investigating. Did you say sexual trauma?
Yes, trauma-informed care based on, you know, there's some statistics that say about 25% of women and 16% of men have been sexually abused. And adverse childhood experiences are said to affect people for life. Should we be taking a look at that?
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, that's a great question because it kind of segues into something else I wanted to mention. And that is that we have, cancer rehabilitation. My department is a part of the Integrative Oncology Services Department. So in that department, we have wonderful people who can help us with that sort of thing. One is Dr. Wendy Baer and her team. In psychiatry. We have the supportive care department as well, and then pain and palliative group as well. I think if I come across patients who have those sorts of issues, sort of out of my scope of practice, of course, being more of a physical medicine and rehabilitation practitioner, I don't hesitate at all to send those patients to that side. And the same, you know, if you're, and I know there's a lot of confusion, we're working on it to try to sort out when you have somebody with this issue, do you send them to cancer pain? Are they best sent to pain palliative? Should it be sent to me for rehabilitation? That's a constant source of confusion. Like I said, we're working on that. We're trying to find a centralized service and kind of better define who does what at Winship. But in the meantime, I think what we're telling everyone is just make the referral. If you feel like it's a pain patient, you want to send them to the pain department. If Dr. Vinitha Singh's group feels like this is somebody who could benefit from rehabilitation, then they'll send them over. If I have somebody, like you mentioned, with these sort of, sexual trauma and different issues like that, or issues with coping, then I don't hesitate to send them over to Dr. Baer or the pain or palliative group. our support, you know, the supportive oncology group here. So just to make the referral is kind of what I would say for that. And we work together very closely, so we'll get them to the right place. And in the meantime, we're working on it, streamlining that process.
Great, that's wonderful to hear. Yeah. Any other questions that I think we are coming to the end of our time here a little bit. Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Well, thank you so much for your talk, and sure, I look forward to seeing you around campus.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you guys for your attention. I appreciate the opportunity. See you guys around.